and that's our next presenter, Chieko Asakawa. And she is known for her work in the research of our Tokyo Research Lab for accessibility. Chieko has been instrumental in furthering accessibility research and development in the past 3 decades. Early digital braille work in the 1980s is still helping the blind community in Japan to access digital braille books. In 1997, her work on the groundbreaking voice browser, IBM's home page reader, which is made available in Japan, the United States, Europe, and Asia, opened up the internet and all the information resources to the blind. She has many other inventions and accomplishments. She's the recipient of numerous awards and government awards. We're very lucky to have her here today, and let me introduce Chieko.
Okay. Thank you, Diane, for the kind introduction. So I'm Chieko Asakawa, and currently, I'm, as Diane introduced, I'm IBM Fellow, and currently I'm also have a title at Carnegie Mellon University as an IBM Distinguished Service Professor. So so microphone quality is okay? Can you understand my Japanese English?
Yes.
Thank you. I feel like my English is not that clear with this microphone. I can speak a little bit better. But anyway, okay, it is a great honor to be here today. And first, when I heard this conference, I had no idea that it's going to be held here in Kona, Hawaii. But after I accepted, I found it. And I'm very happy to be here. And today I'm going to talk about the information accessibility first, briefly, which I spent a lot of time in my career. And then I'm going to switch to the cognitive assistant for people with visual impairments to realize the real-world accessibility. First, please listen to this audio. I'm going to play this audio 2.8 times faster than regular speed. And please pick up any word, okay? Speaker が入らないの? By the way, Hiro Takagi from Tokyo Research, he's going to present this afternoon, is helping my presentation this morning. But he's having a problem with the speaker, or I don't know. Okay, so it was too sudden, so I'll play again, 2.8 times faster. Did you get any word? No? Nothing? Some blind people can recognize half 50%. With this speed. So then let's play 2.4 times faster.
Nanigo?
Test is not better.
Test can't get it.
Yes, great. So anyway, the point is blind people can almost listen everything with this speed. So I will give you the answer with a regular speed. Regular 1.0.
It is delicious to have a cup of jam. Plenty of jam. It is delicious to have a cup of Russian tea with plenty of jam.
Okay, so this is the answer. Maybe now you feel it's a kind of slow. So I will play again with 2.4 times faster.
4.
It is
delicious to have a cup of Russian tea with plenty of jam.
So now I think you can get most of the information with the faster rate. So, but you know, we listen to the information every day. So in voice. So our listening capability is much better than yours. So, you know, people tend to think we have a lot, there are many things that we can do, but using this kind of remaining capability, we can do much more than you imagine. So I want to give you some examples. So we can play a lot of sports: skiing, skating, running, swimming, scuba diving, and even rock climbing. I have some videos. Okay, and then I can cook.
So let's start.
So I'm using some technology. Recipe is read by iPhone. Okay. Anyway, it's not that hard to cook, but it takes time. So I usually recommend it's better to. It was a kind of a Korean food, but I recommend you to eat at a restaurant. It takes a lot of time. Anyway, I can do a lot. Even so, you know, it doesn't mean I can see. So I found there are two difficulties for the blind to live in a society. The first difficulty was to access the information. I lost my sight at the age of 14. In those days, there were no internet, no personal computers, no smartphones. So I couldn't read textbooks, I couldn't read newspapers, magazines, I couldn't read any book by myself. And another difficulty was mobility. I couldn't go to school by myself, I couldn't go shopping by myself, I couldn't go anywhere by myself. I really wanted to be freed from relying on someone. I wanted to be independent. That became my strong need, pushed my back to ignite innovation later in my life. So fast forward to mid-1980s, I joined IBM Research and got to know cutting-edge technologies. I then started working on braille digitalization technologies, such as braille editing system, braille library network, braille dictionary system, and braille library network system. Today, every student who is visually impaired can read textbooks by using personal computers or mobile devices, both in voice or in braille. This may not surprise you, since everybody now has digital books in their tablets. But braille went digital already in the late 1980s. In the 90s, people around me started talking about the internet and web browsing. Somehow, I managed to access the web through an engineering capability. And I remember the first time I went on the web. I could access newspapers at any time, and I could even search for any information by myself. And I noticed it's going to offer us a completely new type of information resource. And I really wanted to help everybody have access to the internet, even those who cannot see like me. Anyway, I found ways to render the web into speech and simplified the user interface. And this led me to develop the IBM Homepage Reader in 1997, first in Japanese and later translated into 11 languages. When I developed the Homepage Reader in 1997, I received many comments from users. One that I strongly remember said, "For me, the internet is a small window to the world." information accessibility opened up independence and opportunities to actively participate in society. Okay, so now I have a short audio that you can experience how you can get information just using the voice.
Kona. The sunny Kona district stretches for about 60 miles from Kona International Airport to Deonkilakekua Bay on Hawaii Island's lava-lined western coast. Along this expansive area, you'll find everything from coffee farms to historic Hawaiian landmarks.
So, I think, you know, even just listening, now you could get some information. So in this way, you know, we can get any information using computers or smartphones. So thanks to the power of iPhone technologies, our capabilities are now getting more and more increasing. So now I'm going to show you, some more demos using smartphones. So I use smartphones every day to get access to the information. So first, iPhone. Volume
high. 10:04 a.m. Press home to lift. Page 2 of 4. Home. Maps. Photos. Page 3 of 4. Lift. KNSB. Money. Calculator. KNSB reader. Arrange apps. Money reader. KNSB reader.
Okay, so by using this application, I can take a photo and, there is an object recognition engine and I can get information of this. I think everybody gets this card, but it doesn't mean anything for me, so I can use this app.
Tilt guidance. Camera flashes on. Tilt guidance. Take picture. Field of view. Take picture. Button. Take picture. Pause.
Ask staff to help you make the most of your Hawaiian. I from basic directions and appointments set into NT recommendations and locals only island tips. It's Aja to customize your trip so you don't miss a beat. The tours and activities desks at the following locations. Iron Tower, across from elevators. Kohiron Tower, above the Kohala Spa on Tower.
Next sentence.
There might be some mistake. I couldn't notice. But anyway. No. So in this way I could get what is written in that card. And now money reader.
Calculator. Money reader. Money reader money. 10,000 Japanese yen. Japan. Money.
What?
Month 20 euro. 10,000 Japanese yen.
20 Mexican
pesos.
Okay. So, anyway, you gotta. So, in this way, I can access to various types of information. And of course, I can use a Lyft or Uber, so I can get, taxi very quickly. So smartphone has been very useful, for us to get deal with in the real world. Okay, so now let me share with you some funny story. So when a smartphone became accessible around 2008, I first used iPhone. But at that time, I thought it's going to be impossible for me to get used to it. So I hoped such a device should not become popular or should not be deployed. But after bumps and detours, now you just saw me. I now cannot imagine my life without a smartphone. And one more story. Researcher in the area of accessibility has submitted a paper related to the smartphone accessibility, but that conference reviewers were not familiar with accessibility research. Anyway, the paper was rejected. The reviewer thought this research is completely useless since the blind people cannot use a smartphone. So, interesting. Anyway, next chart summarizes the dramatic expansion of information accessibility, which I witnessed throughout my career, from paper to digital to the net. The challenge may be quite similar for other people, not just for the blind. But the impact on our lives was much larger than for other people. Before the 1980s, we only had paper braille and tape recorded books as our information resources. Two significant innovations changed the situation. One was braille digitalization, and the other breakthrough was voice-based web access. Okay, in this way, the cyber world became accessible. So the next challenge is the real world accessibility. But before moving on to the real world, let me introduce a bit of my history. I was born as just a normal baby who grew to love sports. People around me at that time could have expected that I might become an Olympic athlete, but no one had any idea that I might become an IBM Fellow in the future. Anyway, you can see my picture when I was 1 year old. And the next picture is when I was a junior high school student. But at that time, I faced a giant challenge. I hit my left eye on the side of a swimming pool when I was 11 years old, and then gradually lost my sight. By the age of 14, I was blind. But the blindness could not prevent me from loving sports. I still enjoy every sport I can try, as you already see. I joined then IBM Research in 1985 after bumps and detours. And at that time, I only had a bachelor degree, but as I continued doing research, I really wanted to do more research for the non-visual user interface. So I entered the University of Tokyo to get a PhD. And it took me for 3 years while working to complete my PhD, but I could manage to complete. And when I finished it in 2004, people around me asked how I managed my work and my study. I always answered, it's not that hard if you study after work, 5 p.m. to midnight every day and all weekends. But anyway, it's a joke. It wasn't that hard. But anyway, after that, I could move on to my research for accessibility. And in 2009, I became IBM Fellow. And also, I have received various types of awards, but one of the great one was from the Medal of Purple Ribbon from Emperor of Japan. And I wanted to show you this picture. I'm with another woman. I'm not sure if you know her. If you are Japanese, everybody knows. Her name is Yumi. She is a great, musician, and I really liked her when I was a teenager. So it was, great honor for me to get such award with her. Okay, so let's go back to the mobility, real-world accessibility. So the challenge for the mobility has been also conducted for many years. In 2004, National Federation of the Blind in the United States has started working with Virginia Institute of Technology for Blind Drivers Challenge. It aimed at enabling the blind to drive a car. It was a part of self-driving challenge. So there is a video on YouTube from 2011. Please take a look.
A title appears, Blind Driver Challenge, Daytona International Speedway.
And hands still extended out the window. He is waving out to the cameraman that was down there, and he is rolling. He is rolling.
Mike Picamoto of the National Federation of the Blind is rolling.
Straight straddling that big double yellow line that we have here, in Canada, which NASCAR drivers know they're not supposed to go below. But here he goes, driving off towards turn one into the infield, and then up there, there will be an obstacle for us, as you can see once he does arrive in that area.
And Kevin, he's not Jordan earlier.
Austin, he blows it out, so don't be littering like your dad and his team.
Well, there comes the first box, and now let's see if Mark avoids it. He does. He passes it on the right. The second box has been deployed, and he passes it on the left. Third box is out, the fourth box is out, and he's perfectly making his way between the two.
So they're throwing boxes out of the back of the van and the black.
The end of the run makes his way in between the barrels that are set up there, and mission accomplished.
We're proud of you, Mark Rigabona. We're proud of the National Federation of the Blind. What a great drive. A great drive in Daytona.
So in this way, various devices such as tactile, globe, it helps blind to understand the angle to car turns a handle, or tactile vest have been developed, and the blind driver could drive a car by avoiding static and dynamic obstacles, driving many turns, passing another, vehicles and so on. By the way, this, challenge was to enable blind people to drive a car by themselves. But Google has also published a blind driver's challenge, but Google is more focusing on self-driving. So blind people can just depend on self-driving, but, car will take you to the destination. So this kind of project have been ongoing a lot. So Uber has started the pilot service of their self-driving cars. Have you ever get a ride of Uber self-driving car in Pittsburgh? Maybe no?
Nobody.
Okay, I did. So right now, if you live in Pittsburgh or if you in Pittsburgh, and if you request an Uber, you cannot directly request, I need a self-driving car. But if you are lucky, self-driving car will come and pick you up. And the good thing is currently it was free. I'm not sure if they changed the policy into 2017, but when I got it was free. So it is really lucky. So I had some video when I experienced. So. So since it's a real world, if anything dangerous happened, the driver has to touch the handle. So I wanted to realize when they control the car by themselves.
So,
so anyway, when I got a ride, it was not that, it was pretty, there were many cars on the road. So he had to touch the handle several times, but he said if there is less car on the road, it almost works automatically. So anyway, it was really fun, and I felt like, in the near future, not near maybe, but someday I will be able to drive a car. But I know it still takes a lot of time until such self-driving vehicles is deployed. However, I really hope, someday I can drive a car. But this is not only just a technical problem. I think we have to deal with, regulations, people understanding, so there should be a lot of issues need to be solved. But anyway, I really hope in the future I can say I cannot think of my life without a self-driving car. Now I am working for the real-world accessibility. Specifically, I'm focusing on technologies that enable us to explore in a city or in a building, and not just exploring, to enjoy exploring in a city. Because I cannot recognize shops around me, products or items in a shop, if it looks delicious, if there is a long line in front of a shop, if someone is approaching me, I cannot perceive all these visual information by myself. Thanks to the advancement of AI technologies, we can now expect to make such dreams come true. We call such a system as cognitive assistant. It of course means assisting technologies powered by cognitive computing technologies, but it also means technologies to supplement or augment missing or weakened abilities of people with disabilities. And not just people with disabilities, it also supplement weakening cognitive abilities of elderly people while aging. Indeed, it has exact meaning of supplementing cognition. So cognitive assistant will always stay with us. So it is indispensable to realize the real-world accessibility. We all now live in the new era that computers can help us real time. So this slide shows my exact goal. It is very, very old Japanese animated cartoon character. I liked it when I was a child and could watch it. The little bird on his shoulder is a robot. It helps the boy by whispering to him about everything around him, from the weather to approaching enemies. It was, of course, science fiction in those days. The boy's mother, who come from the different universe, helped the boy in a battle by turning into the bird. But in the era of IoT, the bird could be no longer fiction, but possible by technologies. Do you agree with me? So it could, notify me traffic signs, crossing, or bicycles on the street, stairs, escalators, elevators, any information for me to, walk by myself. And maybe for the social, who are in the meeting room, and their facial expressions, such as smiling, serious, boring, sleepy, sleeping. So maybe if such technology is available, the system can whisper to me, like your average age, ratio of men and women. So those necessary visual information could be notified to me by using these technologies. So actually, I talked at the TED 1 year ago, and at that time, I shared the vision of cognitive assistant using the video. So please take us that video.
Okay, now let me show you the latest technologies. This is a smartphone that we are working on. 51 feet to the door and keep straight. Take the two doors to go out the doors on your right. Nick is approaching. Looks so happy.
Oh, hi, Nick. Where are you going? You look so happy.
Oh, well, my people just got accepted.
Oh, that's great. Congratulations.
Thanks. Wait, how'd you know it was me? And that I look happy?
Hi.
Oh, hi.
He is not talking to you, but on his phone. Potato chips.
Two, three, four, five.
Dark chocolate with almonds. You gained 5 pounds since yesterday. Please take a bonus of chocolate. Approaching. You are right. Now.
Okay. So, you know, in the video, we show the navigation application. We call it NavCog. So, NavCog is now available via App Store. And we also open sourced all the NavCog related components. And currently, we are jointly closely working with Carnegie Mellon University for the real world accessibility. And actually, you know, Chris Kitani, a faculty member from Computer Vision, was going to come today, but due to the severe conflict, he couldn't make it. Anyway, I am also physically working at Carnegie Mellon University right now to lead the joint research for cognitive assistant for the visual impairments between IBM and Carnegie Mellon University. So now I want to emphasize that the technologies in the video are advancing rapidly to realize the goal of cognitive assistant. And I categorize necessary technologies into four. First, localization technologies. Localization is one of the critical bases for cognitive assistant to enable location-based intelligent assistant. Any sensors should be used for a highly accurate localization and integrated to cope with various environmental situations, both indoor and outdoor. Otherwise, it cannot meet requirements from blind people or like people with a wheelchair. So ideally, we really need to achieve 1 foot step forward accuracy. So I think you've seen the white cane. Blind people are holding white cane when we walk. White cane can check the 1 foot step forward. So if our localization technology achieved that accuracy, we can, you know, depend on the technology. So the next, we have demonstrated our technology at the World of Boston, and there is some video, and you can check how accurately we achieved.
Welcome. Now proceed to Hudson General Store. Proceed 4 feet. Turn left. Proceed 17 feet on the parquet, then turn right at the USPS box. A road with heavy traffic is on your left. Turn right. Proceed 10 feet, then turn right. A small park is on your left. Turn right. Proceed 20 feet on the grass, then turn left at the tree. Flowers are on your left. A bookstore is on your right. A dentist is on your right. A pharmacy is on your right. A dog is on your left. Turn left. Proceed 13 feet, then turn left. A pound of ducks is on your right. Turn left. Proceed 19 feet, then turn left. Turn left. Watson General Store is in 5 feet. You are right. Watson General Store is on your left. What do
okay.
you want to buy?
So... Okay, so to reach this accuracy, we are using any sensor available, such as eye beacons, pedometers from the smartphones, and so on. So the next is vision technologies. So vision technology enables us to see. So in the video, it showed an object recognition like chocolates or apples, face recognition and facial expression. And as you know, facial related technologies are almost getting ready for the real world and real time purposes. And using the vision technologies, we can recognize surrounding environment while localizing with highly accurate localization. And we have some videos as well.
Calmar is on your right.
What do you want to buy?
And a cookie.
Starting navigation to cookies. Please hold iPhone in front. Turn left 15 degrees. Two steps forward. Bit forward. You're in front of the cookies. Six kinds of cookies are there at left side. Second shelf from the top. Ritz Bits peanut butter, 140 calories. Oreo, 130 calories. There are many ways to eat Oreo. Do you want to check recipes?
Sure.
Please buy my book on the right side of the top shelf. Cognitive Cooking with Chef Watson. Recipes for Innovation from IBM and the Institute of Culinary Education.
Okay, so in this way, computer vision help us to find the exact, you know, item we need. And also, in this demo, we are also using the barcode reader. Barcode reader is already ready to go. So we are integrating, you know, any technology that can make our life easier. And the technology we just showed, we should apply these technologies to avoid obstacles in the real world, such as poles, trash cans, chairs, tables, and so on. So so the next topic is object recognition technology. So this slide shows the example from IBM Watson. So Watson is recognizing daily goods, such as coffee cups, wine glasses, a pair of glasses, and so on. And as you know, by deep learning technology, we can train an engine by ourselves. So we are now working to use photos taken by blind users themselves as training data. Maybe you have noticed when I did demonstration using the smartphone, Hiro has helped me to take a good photo. So we are now, so the challenge is how we can automatically navigate blind people to take a good photo. But if we can make it, we can train the system to recognize our own items, such as bottles of ingredients in the kitchen and t-shirts. Why t-shirts? You know, it's very important. I have a lot of t-shirts from all over the world, but I can never recognize which one is which. So, but I think technology can help me to figure out in the future. So we need to solve the issue to how we can navigate blind people to take a good photo. So I have been I've been training to take a good photo, by my own, sense and by using a technology. And we have formally done the user study this summer, and our paper was accepted by ACMKI, so we are going to report this progress coming April. Okay, so next is data. So as you already saw through the demonstration, the recognized result has been connected to related information such as health information or products information. So it needs to be connected appropriate knowledge. Especially, it should be linked to a map and shop information to enjoy exploring in the city. But as indoor map belongs to the owner of each building. It is not publicly available, while outdoor map is governed by each government. We need a new strategy to train AI by opening maps and any other image to train AI. In this way, we can realize the real-world accessibility. So we are now preparing an open data server to present those information to users using our navigation system. So we need to register the real world information such as shop information, sale information, static and dynamic obstacles in the corridor or on the street, crowded spot with people, and so on. We really expect, you know, such data should be also useful to improve AI-related research and development, not just for accessibility needs. So finally, I said, you know, core technology is divided into four. And the final, the last one is interaction technology. As you know, the accuracy of speech recognition has been dramatically improved. Microsoft has announced that accuracy of their speech recognition has reached the same level as a human. Of course, it is under a specific condition, but it has reached the point that used to be impossible. So we can expect interaction technology is going to be very new based on the voice dialogue system. So now this is going to be a real demo. I hope it's going to work. So now we are working to demonstrate our concierge system, which we are preparing to demonstrate later January at a shopping mall in Japan. This app is enabled by combining conversational concierge interface and navigation system. Okay, so this time Hiro is going to demonstrate.
I want to go to Chinese restaurant.
You search for Chinese. There are three candidates in Korean neurology. Chisan and Nihonmachi. Song. Do you have gift and dummy which store would you like to visit?
The first one.
I'm sorry I could not hear you, so please select again any of the three candidates. Details. We'll provide the details about the store.
Second one.
Shall I take you to some?
Yes.
Let me start navigation. Please proceed with caution around.
So it will directly navigate to the restaurant by using such the accurate localization technology we demonstrated. So it's a combination of Watson, we combined Watson conversation API and also the some you know, location-based search engine behind it. I guess. So I want to show you another example.
May I help you?
I want to go to sushi restaurant with wines. Sorry.
We have a variety of foods in Korean neurology such as teriyaki, Italian, and Chinese as well as Thai and Swedes. Which types are you searching for?
Sushi restaurant
with wines.
I want to go to sushi restaurant with wine.
Thank you.
Would you like to visit Sushi Nihonmachi Seaman? Kurido sends recommendation.
Yes. So in this way, you know, we combine the search engine, conversation API, and enable this concierge.
Okay, so the point of this system is not just searching the shops, it will navigate to the destination, and the accuracy is doable for the blind and people with wheelchair, but we are also targeting foreigners. So if next time if you visit Japan, please go to Koredo, Muromachi, while we are doing the public service, so you can enjoy shopping, dining, and so on. So we have already installed almost 300 beacons, and there are three large buildings. So anyway, this kind of interface was previously very difficult to develop and it took time. But now, you know, combining of language technologies and machine learning technologies, it makes much easier to develop. So I'm pretty sure this kind of interface is going to be around us in the near future. Okay, next, robot. Robot can be an important form of our, you know, cognitive assistant. So, you know, Brady has, you know, talked about the cobot, but this is about the cobot. So this picture is me followed by an, you know, cobot. Cobot is an autonomous mobile robot. And this robot, it was developed by Manuela Veloso and her student. It has a novel localization algorithm based on depth images, and which enables it to robustly navigate in Carnegie Mellon University campus buildings. And Cobot can perform item transportation and escort service tasks. When the Christmas comes, Cobot comes in front of our offices and give us chocolates. Since 2013, there are four at this moment, they have already autonomously traveled over 1,000 kilometers. So I think Cobot can be a foundation for creating new assisting robot, which will help us walk around, shop around, and enjoy the view of the environment. And as Grady said, robot doesn't need to do everything. You know, the robot is going to be with us, so we can push the buttons of elevators, and maybe if it is not heavy, we can carry the robot when there is a staircase. So we have already received a national NSF award to do research in this direction. So the title of the award was Cognitive Navigation Assistant for the Blind. So in 2020, the Japanese government plans to hold a robot competition called World Robot Summit in Tokyo. It is the same year as the 2020 Tokyo Olympics and Paralympics Games in Tokyo. And I have been working as a board member of the advisory board meeting committees. And now we have been heavily discussing what kind of, you know, games should be involved. But anyway, the category has been already confirmed. There are three, service robot, industrial robot, and resiliency robot. And I'm especially interested in service robot area. So it would be wonderful to see, you know, various kind of cognitive assisting robot for service purposes. And I think they are going to announce more information in this month to get attention from all over the world. Okay, so accessibility needs has ignited innovations. Let me give you some examples. You know, telephones. Telephones was invented while developing a communication tool for hearing impaired people in 1800s. Some keyboards were invented to help hand motor disabilities so that they can write letters. You probably know that captions for TV programs were invented for deaf people, but now widely used for such uses as sports bars and to help immigrants. And you can easily imagine how OCR and voice recognition work was motivated by the needs of people with disability. In this way, there is an ongoing trend from accessibility to general use. IBM has been a big part of this history. IBM was founded in 1911, and back in 1914, IBM hired its first employee with a disability. That was remarkably early, long before society paying attention to such issues. In the 60s, IBM developed a talking typewriter shown in this slide. Have you ever used such a typewriter in your life? Not with voice, but typewriter. No? 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 Yes? Ah, good.
A few.
In this way, because I don't have a technology yet, I always use this slide in the beginning so that I can imagine the average age of the audience. But anyway, it's already the end of the presentation. Doesn't matter. By 1975, we had already created a braille printer by rebuilding mainframe printer. And this talking terminal, 3217 terminal, was developed in 1984, and you can see me using the terminal. So various applications to help people with disabilities have been developed over the past two decades, and we have been striving to make our products and services accessible for everybody. Okay. So this is the last slide. Okay. Let me foresee the future. The real-world accessibility challenge has started when a smartphone became accessible for the blind around 2010. And Apple Siri showed the possibility in 2011. And when I made a TED Talk October 2015, I showed the vision of a cognitive assistant. Microsoft launched Seeing AI project in 2016, Google announced first smartphone with 3D recognition features in 2016. I believe we are now in a phase of dramatic expansion to develop core technologies for the next generation. I want to make 2020 Tokyo Olympics and Paralympics a turning point for wider social implementation by demonstrating these core technologies. My point is, next several years, the era to explore next generation core technologies will be very, very exciting. Many technologies are advancing rapidly, such as vision, speech, and so on. We already have seeds of core technologies. I hope we can jointly work to achieve the goal of cognitive assistant and break the barrier for real world and realize the exponential growth of the real world accessibility. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chieko. Are there questions for Chieko? You said some of the technologies mm-hmm. that you have invented are available mm-hmm. in open source mm-hmm. and are available. Is there a mm-hmm. library of what is available?
So to develop the NavCog application navigation system, you need a lot of components, to install the beacons and to get sampling data and to write a map. So we have developed all these tools and it is available on Bluemix. So if you want to get those information, you can visit Facebook. So we have a Facebook/NavCog. So if you use our open source, you can basically develop navigation system for your area. And on top of it, you can do various research, like what we have been doing using Watson conversational system, as you see.
Okay. Excellent. So I mentioned before, if you're a faculty or a student, you get no charge access to Bluemix through IBM on the Hub. It's part of our academic initiative. And if you need more information about that, my colleague Linda Kennedy is at a blue table out of the corner, a blue table that says IBM, and she can get you up and running on the Hub or answer your questions about getting information. Other questions for Chieko? Jim?
Yeah, hi. Jim here. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you again.
Here, and what a wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
Augmenting human capabilities. And I'm just wondering if you could say a little. I turned 61 in a few days, so I'm getting up there. And I'm just wondering how you see this technology evolving and how all of us as we grow older.
You know, you mean, you know, if these technologies will be also useful for elderly people?
Yes.
Yes, yes. Actually, you know, I talked about the cognitive assistant for the visual impairment, but I always believe, you know, if we can solve the issues faced by blind people, we can help everybody. And, you know, as we have, and you know, as Grady talked about elderly care, Japan is the oldest country, you know, in the world. So we are now, you know, we have started working with our customers, and Hiro is going to talk about it in the afternoon. So we really want to, you know, help elderly people as well, so that, you know, our society is going to be active, and we really want to make elderly people active in our society. So active aging, creating or helping to make elderly people active is one of our big goals. And of course, please expect to use a cognitive assistant for you.
So Hiro is going to be speaking this afternoon about cognitive assistance for the elderly. So that will be interesting. Are there any other questions for Chieko? Well, Chieko and Hiro, thank you very, very much. That was fascinating.
Thank you very much.